Hi, I'm Mike Marin, and in this video, we'll discuss implementing a bootstrap approach to hypothesis testing, comparing a numeric variable for two groups, and we'll do all this using R. This can be thought of as an alternative approach to the two-sample t-test comparing independent groups. In a separate video, I explain in much more detail the concept as well as the general approach to the test that we're going to run here. I highly recommend that you watch that video first if you haven't already. You can find the link to that video in the video description below. A quick reminder to subscribe and click on the bell to receive notifications when we upload new videos. First, let's import the dataset. I'm going to work without attaching the data. If we'd like to see the data in the data viewer, we can do that by using the view command here. We can see that this data consists of comparing weight gain for chicks on two different diets, casein and meat meal. We can have a quick look at the variable names. We can see that we have both the weight as well as the feed type, the levels of the feed type, casein and meat meal, as well as how many observations there are in each of these two feed types, 12 on casein and 11 on meat meal, so a pretty small sample size. If we'd like to visually compare the weight gain for the two different feed types, we can use side-by-side box plots. Here we can see visually there's a bit of evidence that the casein may be gaining a bit more weight than meat meal, but we'd like to test this more formally. Now previously, we decided to run two different tests at the same time for the sake of demonstration. The first test statistic that we'll calculate will be the absolute value of the difference in the mean weight for the two diets. Now this is the same test statistic used in a two-sided, two-sample t-test. The second test statistic will be the absolute value of the difference in median weights for the two diets. Now at the end of the R script used in this video, we also provide code for using a test statistic of the absolute value of the difference in the 90th percentile of weights for the two different diets. Again, just for the sake of looking at using a slightly different test statistic. Now let's get to calculating the two test statistics. The first thing we can do is calculate the mean for each of the different feed types. Here we can ask R to take the weight variable and subset or remove only those whose feed type is casein, and then calculate the mean for us. We can see that's 323.58. Now we can do the same, getting the mean this time for meat meal. And I also like to include some more advanced ways of using R in this code that you can work through and explore a little bit more on your own. So this can produce the exact same results using the with command as well as a tapply. Then we can calculate the test statistic 1 and we can store it in an object called test.stat1. Let's do that here, and we can see the absolute value of the difference in means is 46.67. And again, a way you can explore on your own makes use of the difference command as well as with and a tapply to produce the same results. Now, we can quickly do the exact same to calculate test statistic 2. We can ask R to calculate the median weight only for those on the casein feed type, as well as the median weight for those on the meat meal feed type. And again, we can do that in a slightly more advanced way, making use of the with and tapply command. And let's take the absolute value of the difference in medians and store it in something called test.stat2. Here we can see our test statistic 2, the absolute value of the difference in median weight for feed type casein and feed type meat meal is 79. And again, making use of the difference command, we can get that here. Now, I won't discuss these in this video, but you can have a look at the three different options of the more classical approaches to hypothesis testing, comparing the weight of the two different feed types here. You could use the large sample, two-sample t-test, comparing the means for the two feed types. You could use the Wilcoxon or Mann-Whitney u-test. This compares the medians for the two different feed types. Or you could also use the Kolmogorov-Smirnov two-sample test. Again, this is comparing the distributions of the two different feed types. So let's get to talking about how to do a bootstrapping approach here. So to do so, I'm going to use the following code. First, I'm going to set a seed. Now, setting a seed is not necessary, but what it does is it allows you to get the exact same set of random data each time you run this code. Okay, so it's not necessary, but it will allow me to say run this code in a week's time and get the exact same results as I'm getting now. If I don't set the seed, every time I do a random resample, I'll get a slightly different set of data. So I'm just doing this for reproducibility. Now the next few commands are to help me make the code a bit more general so that I can easily take this code and change it to use on a new set of data, but not have to change very much in the code. So I'm going to use n here to set the number of observations in the data, which we saw was 23. I'm going to use b to be the number of bootstrap resamples or bootstrap datasets I'd like to take. I'm going to start with 10,000, and you can on your own explore increasing this and see what happens if you want. And finally, I'm going to set the variable to the variable that I want to resample from. So rather than asking it to resample weights, I'm just going to use variable as a more generic term. Again, so I can take a new set of data and I can just change the variable I'm using, but not have to change the entire set of code. Now let's take a look at exactly what this code here is doing. This code is going to generate all B equals 10,000 bootstrap resample datasets at once. Since a bootstrap approach resamples with replacement, we can select all the n equals 23 observations times the b equals 10,000 observations or bootstrap samples all at once. So here, what I'm going to ask R to do is to resample with replacement from our variable, right? That is the weights. And we're going to take n times b, okay, 23 times 10,000 observations all at once. We can ask R to fill these 23 by 10,000 observations into a matrix that has 23 rows and B equals 10,000 columns. So what this is going to do is it's going to produce a 23 by 10,000 matrix where each of the 10,000 columns is a bootstrap resample. So let's submit that code here. And we can see just like that, we've already done all 10,000 bootstrap resamples. We can check the dimensions of that to make sure things went as planned. We can see we have this matrix called bootstrap samples. That's a 23 by 10,000 matrix. But again, 23 rows, right? The rows referring to the observations, 10,000 columns, each of those columns being a bootstrap sample. Now what we need to do is we need to calculate the test statistic 1 and test statistic 2 for each of the 10,000 bootstrap resamples or each of the columns. Now the code I'm going to use to do this can be made a little bit more efficient. But what I want is I want the code I'm using to be very clearly visible in exactly what the code is trying to do. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create two empty vectors to store the 10,000 bootstrap test statistics in, one for each of the test statistics. So I'm going to create boot.test.stat1, again a vector of 10,000 zeros, as well as boot.test.stat2, another vector of 10,000 zeros. Now what we're going to do is we're going to calculate the test statistic for each of those bootstrap resamples using a loop. And again, this code could be made much more efficient by writing a function and then applying this function to the columns of the bootstrap samples matrix, but I'm keeping the code more transparent for now. We will loop through, and at first, for I equals 1, we will go into the bootstrap samples matrix, column I equals 1, and we're going to calculate the mean for the first 12 observations, or the mean for the 12 casein observations. And we will then subtract from this the mean of observations 13 to 23, and this is the mean for the 11 meat meal observations. We will take the absolute value of this difference, and we're going to store it in boot.test.stat1 in position I equals 1. Now you can see down here, we're going to do the same for test statistic 2, the absolute difference in medians. We then have this repeated for I equals 2, I equals 3, all the way up to I equals B of 10,000, right? For each of the 10,000 bootstrap resamples. So let's submit all of that code here and have R run through the loop, calculating the 10,000 test statistics. Now let's quickly remind ourselves of the observed test statistics. A reminder, the absolute difference in means was 46.67. That's what we observed in our sample. And the absolute value of the difference in medians was 79. Now we can take a look at just the first 20 bootstrap test statistics. First for test statistic 1, the first 20, and then the first 20 for test statistic 2. And let's remind ourselves of the definition or the calculation of the p-value. A reminder that stated generically, the p-value tells us under a certain set of assumptions or a certain model, what's the probability of getting our observed test statistic, or one even more extreme or larger, if the null hypothesis is true. Focusing on our test statistic 1, this is going to tell us what's the probability of getting a test statistic greater or equal to 46.67, the one we observed, if the null hypothesis were true, and we'd expect the test statistic to be roughly zero. Now, taking a look at the first 20 Bootstrap test statistics for test statistic 1 that were generated under the assumption that the null hypothesis is true, we can see that only 1 out of the 20 times, that 48, did we actually get a Bootstrap test statistic greater than the observed one of 46.67. Again, recall that the p-value is calculated as the number of Bootstrap test statistics that are greater than the observed one divided by b, the total number of Bootstrap test statistics. So let's go through and have R calculate that. First, let's take note that we can ask R true or false questions. So here we're going to ask, is the Bootstrap test statistic greater than the observed test statistic? We're going to do that here for only the first 20. So here we can see we're returned false, 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 true, false, false, and so on. So again, we're asking that question, is that first one, 14.7, greater than the observed test statistic of 46.67? And we're returned a false. We can see the only one we're returned a true for is the sixth position, right, which is the 48. Is that 48 greater than the observed test statistic of 46.67? Yes, it is, or true. Now, if we ask R for the mean of a bunch of true or falses, it will treat a false as a value of 0 and a true as a value of 1. So let's take a look at doing that here. Here we're going to ask R, is the Bootstrap test statistic greater than the observed one, right, true or false, and give us the mean of those. Here we can see we returned 0.0832. So here we have a p-value of 8.32%. We can also interpret this, out of the 10,000 Bootstrap test statistics we calculated, 832 of them had test statistics greater than the observed one. So again, taking an interpretation of that p-value of roughly 8%, what it's telling us is if there is no difference in the mean weights under the two feed types, we'd see an absolute difference in the sample means of 46.67 or more by chance, roughly 8% of the time. So again, stated a bit more generically, p-values tell us what's the probability of getting the test statistics we got, or more extreme, if the null is true. We can think of it, what's the probability of seeing data like we saw, or more extreme, if the null is true. Now we can also have R go through and calculate the p-value for test statistic 2. Doing that, we'd see it comes out to 6.3%. Now I'd like to bring up a reminder of the difference between statistical significance and scientific significance. We've talked a lot about this over a lot of our videos. Right? We don't want to get too stuck on that magical cutoff of alpha being 5%, and a p-value of 6.3% not being statistically significant, where suppose a p-value of 4% being statistically significant. We don't want to be too rigid in our decision. Right? So while this difference is not statistically significant, we do have some evidence that the diets may be a little bit different and it's worth exploring more. Also a reminder, if we look back at the sample sizes, we only had 12 observations on casein, 11 on meat meal. So we really don't have that much data to find statistical significance, but we do have evidence that these diets may differ and worth exploring further. Also a reminder that in this R script, we've included some code to make a plot of the sampling distribution of the Bootstrap test statistics, as well as explore a hypothesis test comparing the absolute difference in the 90th percentile of weight for the two diets. So you can feel free to explore this a little bit more on your own if you want. I'd also like to bring back that we've talked a lot about how confidence intervals and not hypothesis tests may be a little bit more useful, or at least that anytime when doing a hypothesis test, we should also include a confidence interval to give us an idea of how big do we think the difference may be between these two feed types. In the video to follow this one, we explore using a Bootstrap approach to build a confidence interval for the difference in means and the difference in medians using this exact same data set. So look for that to come.
Subscribe to our channel, share our videos. Stick around, guys, because we got lots more. Thanks for watching our video.